Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Cube Pod. I'm John Furrier. We're here in Maui for ACTAI Global. It's a group of people that come together, experts, investors, builders, entrepreneurs, industry leaders, and they chill. They have an intellectual retreat in the morning, kite surfing in the afternoon. Amanda's here. She's principal in the whole organization. She's the head honcho behind Bill Tye. Bill's the head honcho.
He's the Bill. Yeah, he's
Bill yeah. Tye runs a great community. Yeah. Bill brings a lot of people around him. And what's interesting is it's a targeted group of people that's a trust network. There's a lot of sharing. There's a lot of action. And people are bouncing ideas. Companies get formed here. Canva's the big success story. Many more other projects. I had a couple of great ideas I was kicking around last night that connected for me. Just spirit of doing podcasts here. Just sharing is a great culture. Thank you for what you do. We appreciate all the work that goes
Thank
into
you.
This.
Yeah, really fortunate. I mean, I don't know if you've mentioned this in your other podcast, but yeah, ACTAI Global stands for athletes, conservationists, technologists, artists, and innovators. So we're really trying to bring not just technology people, although there's a lot of obviously founders, investors that come, but really people from all different kind of genres. And our mission is around ocean conservation and also around economic empowerment via entrepreneurship. And so that's what the nonprofit's about.
And what I love about the nonprofit is that it doesn't have like an agenda other than bringing people together to create value amongst each other and for the society. But also there's an air of the benefit of doing that is potentially business benefits. And I love the talks in the morning because it's very chill. It's not a hard, there's no hard sell. There's no selling. It's just more people sharing what they're working on. And the panels are topical. I ended up hosting them.
Yes, thank you so much.
Thanks for letting me know.
You were great, John.
Okay?
Yeah, you were great. Okay, you were great. Thank you so much. You brought professionalism to another level and all those
podcasts. It's a lot easier when the guests are like, the panelists are like super awesome and brilliant. But we were on a panel on Bitcoin. I think it was originally called Bitcoin, Native Bitcoin Innovation. Then it became kind of like a hybrid financial Bitcoin. But what you're working on is an area that we've talked about on theCUBE in our Palo Alto studios around the native L1. There's a lot of action at the infrastructure. I had to balance out kind of the business side because it's money, because Wall Street, look at Wall Street. I mean, Brian Bauman and I were seeing all the action in New York City at the NYSE. The mainstreaming of crypto in general is hot, but there's still so much action going on at the infrastructure L1. This is what we talked about last time. So give an update of what you guys are working on, because the on-chain asset, real-world asset, also applies to other things, and especially, you know, the work you're doing.
Right. I mean, as you know, Bitcoin was really just started in 2009. So we're talking about an asset that's 15, 16 years old. So it's kind of crazy when you think, when you just zoom out, how much of an impact, right? It's the fifth largest asset class, you know, in the world now. It's only 16 years old, right? Mm-hmm. And now in the last 2 years, which is very exciting, there's been a new protocol called the Ordinals protocol, which was developed by Casey Rodemore. And it's the first time that it's enabling data, so music, art, anything to be inscribed directly on the Bitcoin L1. And obviously I'm the co-founder of Metagood, which created the NFT collection Onchain Monkey, which was the first 10,000 NFTs. So first kind of digital collectible art on Bitcoin. Yeah. The significance of that is because before that market was really all on Ethereum. So what people owned was a digital certificate pointing to an IPFS, you know, offline file storage system. So, you know, you don't pay your AWS bills, a founder is anon and decides to kind of quote unquote rug the project, and you don't actually own the art. And what's so beautiful about Ordinals is everything is on chain. So all of these monkeys, like this monkey, there's, you know, we have multiple collections. They're kind of like the Lascaux cave paintings in France, where they will outlive all the people that created them.
This is important because I think what's happening, people kind of like that aren't in the industry don't kind of follow the balls and strikes of the game. NFTs, non-fungible tokens, became quite the rage. It woke up the world to you can have a digital asset. Because Bitcoin was digital currency.
Right, store of value.
Store of value. Yep. Ethereum, not ideal for NFTs for the reasons you mentioned. And then you saw people realize, well, I have this baseball card collection, or I'm Steph Curry, or I want to preserve physical and maybe digital art or digital, you know, assets. And Bitcoin is immutable with all the benefits. Why Bitcoin works as a store of value. So you start to see kind of NFT 2.0, and I think your company, of which has, I think, the on-chain monkey, I think is a proxy for what's coming.
Yes.
Would you agree that what the on-chain monkey is doing is just the beginning of other things that could be on there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've been very pioneering. Obviously, we literally worked with the Ordinals protocol team to do the first test parent-child transactions, which kind of shows the children are these NFTs that mm-hmm. roll up into a parent collection. Mm-hmm. So first of that kind, we also launched the first 3D generative art yeah. on Bitcoin, and we created open source libraries, which other artists have been using that code base yeah. to put their art onto Bitcoin. So it's not just on-chain music collection. Yeah. We really believe in kind of this art on Bitcoin movement, and Bitcoin and Ordinals protocol is being basically a new canvas for art, right?
If you look at art, I was talking with Edward Zhang, who's got this art tech vision, and the people who collect art, they don't know how to buy digital art. Like, if you look at all the art stuff and all the e-commerce that goes on, like, they're buying paintings.
Yeah.
Like this, a new generation, and all the artists are using digital tools to create art, so there's not a lot of painting going on.
Yeah, no, it's all code, right? It's all generated by code.
So I see a huge tsunami coming on the e-commerce side of it. What's your take on, what's your reaction to that? You agree?
It's still early. Like, the infrastructure is still early, still not easy. I mean, you still, you know, from your bank account, you need to open some type of, you know, Coinbase or something account to fund a wallet. You still need to download, you know, an Xverse or Magic. You need a wallet to custody the Ordinal. So it's not the most frictionless thing today to own art on Bitcoin.
But it's
working. Everything is going to be on chain, and it's still early days, right? And what's so beautiful about Ordinals is, it's really, you know, there's rare sats that you're inscribing the art
Explain
on.
Explain Ordinals for people that don't know what Ordinal protocol
is. It's 1/100 millionth of a Bitcoin. So it's literally the smallest unit of Bitcoin possible. And they're rare ones. So, like, our OCM Genesis collection are all on block 9, 450x sats, which was literally the first Bitcoin mined by Satoshi given to Hal Finney. So very, very, very historic. Mm-hmm. And then there's many different ways you can use sats outside of, you know, other chains that don't have some of the complexities.
So there's scarcity involved here.
Oh, there's definitely scarcity. Yeah, there's scarcity in block space. There's scarcities in the amount it will cost to inscribe data onto Bitcoin. So, over time, I don't think there's going to be a bazillion, 10,000 collections of high quality art. It just will get too expensive over time, which is what's so beautiful that we're still kind of in the early innings of people learning about digital art ownership on chain. And, you know, we're trying to always do our part, which
So people might say,
educating people.
Great stuff. How do you make a business out of it? So talk about the business model, how you guys look at this. You shared some stats in there. Probably don't want to go into it now, but, like, there's a lot going on in this early formation and growth phase. What's your thinking around how you make it a business? Obviously, you're contributing a lot, but where's the business?
I mean, we have a relatively small team today, and, you know, every time we do a mint, we're bringing in millions and millions of dollars. So it's like, it does take a lot of work to get there, but launching digital assets is a very profitable, high margin business. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've also created a marketplace called Osura, OSURA, which we're enabling other artists to also launch collections on. So, the royalty model, which was originally part of NFTs, it's like, okay, once you sell and you trade, royalties go back to the artist, which was a very unique proposition for artists, right? Because in a gallery, you sell your art, you don't ever see anything coming back. That's kind of gone away, unfortunately, but it's still a very, you know, for anyone.
So it's transactional and it's digital.
Yeah, it's digital. There's a small but very growing market of people who appreciate digital art and who want to be part of mints and hope to get, you know, really rare art on blockchain.
All right, so what's next for you and the team as you guys look at your mission, you're executing, what's your focus?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it's still really educating people on the art on Bitcoin and, like, what is happening in that space. We have a number of artists. We've worked with Alexi Andre, who is one of the top artists for Art Blocks. Mm-hmm. We helped him do his first 10,000 generative art collection on Bitcoin. We've worked with Brian Brinkman. We've worked with Pactor Amadon. These are all artists who've been in Christie, Sotheby's. So, you know, we're very fortunate. My co-founder, Danny Yang, founded the Stanford Bitcoin Meetup in 2013. Yeah. He created the largest Bitcoin crypto exchange called MyCoin, which is in Taiwan, likely going public next year, and Blockseer, which government agencies use for blockchain, and he sold that in 2018. So OG Bitcoin builder. And we are, you know, still relatively in the early innings of this space. So we're going to be working with more artists, bringing them to Bitcoin, educating people on this. And, you know, who knows down the line? I mean, art is relatively deregulated in terms of putting things on chain. But I think that there are many use cases for putting real world assets on chain and to tokenize them. So, you know, I'm, you know, can't announce anything yet, but we are starting and we've starting to build the infrastructure and we have the know-how how to do this for art. There are many other assets which could be going on chain.
What's exciting about you have a great team, and as the products and the technology unfolds, you guys will be there to seize the moment. I think there's going to be a tsunami of real world assets in trading scenarios. We're already seeing it in the financial communities.
Yes.
The NYC Wire and the Cube's content, we did Crypto Trailblazers, you were part of.
Yes.
We saw a lot of folks come in from the financial side, not from the tech side. They're money makers. They're like, whoa, this is a market here. So I think when real world assets on chain hit, it's a whole nother paradigm. It's not the old school ways of doing things.
Right.
So I think being ready with the team is
and the
key.
Technology and the know-how and
how do you keep up as a leader? You got to be on your toes all the time.
Well, you know, a lot of our
kind of like kiteboarding.
A lot of our community is on Twitter, so I'm like always on Twitter reading everything. You know, to connect directly with the community, they're really in Discord. So we have, you know, our on-chain monkey Discord. So I'm always reading all the channels, seeing what's going on. I'm flying later today to the Bitcoin Vegas conference, which is the world's largest gathering of Bitcoiners. We'll be doing an on-chain monkey gathering tomorrow morning. I'm going to be speaking at the conference tomorrow afternoon. So, you know, it's great to do online, but it's always, as you know, like these type events, there's always magic that happens in real life with other people, with other builders and investors. So I'm sure I'll get a lot of alpha.
Okay, so let's talk about the beautiful place we are right now behind us. It's pretty special. ACTAI, special community. Bill's had a legendary career. I remember knowing of him before meeting him for the first time 20 years ago. And just, he's always in the right place. And then now you got people coming into that gravity. It's like the Milky Way. It's like the star clusters are coming together. It's a lot of gravity. What's your takeaway from this week? It seemed like it'd be a strong week. I mean, I have nothing to compare it to, but I thought it was exceptional. What's your takeaway?
I mean, speaking of Bill, he always says, you know, I'd rather be lucky than smart, but smart is putting yourself in the path of luck.
Yeah.
And so events like this, you know, choosing to be here, being active, is really like choosing the path to put yourself in the best possible place to be lucky with all the things that come out of this, right? So I think there's going to be always at these events, people might meet a co-founder, they get funding, they come up with a new idea. We just launched a token to support ocean conservation called Reefs. It's R-E-E-F-S that's going to actually benefit the Maui Research Center here, which is doing a ton of incredible work, you know, about like making sure and protecting and getting the data to protect the reefs here in Maui. And so that was a completely new concept being done by a token, right, on Solana. So there's always cool things that happen at these events.
My father used to have an expression, hang around the barbershop long enough, you'll get a haircut. I think the Bill Tai philosophy of putting people together. I remember in Web 2.0 when I started podcasting 20 years ago when it was just starting, we called it LobbyCon. LobbyCon, you hang out at the lobby of the conferences, and then the unconference movement happened, if you remember. And that was because the propensity of people to collide and just without an agenda, just naturally kind of bump into each other, or, you know, metaphorically, intellectually bump into each other, creates propensity to create serendipity and invention.
Yeah.
And that's how all the best startups and best things happen. Yeah. Is random. It seems random, but it's not. I think Bill gets that 100%. I would love that about him, because you put people together, it's magic or it's going to collision.
I think there's also this, but like the human potential is really only unlocked when, you know, in like with other people, right? Like, so.
Yeah. And the protocol is kind of as an untold protocol. It's like in sports, unwritten rules. When you're in that environment, you kind of nurture it. you got to, you know, and you guys do an amazing job. So congratulations and thank you for what you do. And thanks for coming on and sharing
Unchained
Monkey and your business and ventures, because it's just getting started.
Just getting started. Yeah. Very exciting. Obviously, Bitcoin all-time high last week. I think people are very excited, obviously, going to the conference. You know, Ordinals Protocol and Runes has literally contributed $700 million in fees to miners since it launched 2 years ago. So it's also helping to secure the Bitcoin network. And so I think it's going to be a phenomenal conference.
You had me at high margins.
High margins, small team. So very, very, very profitable business. Too.
You're also investing as well. You're also,
I do run a pre-seed seed stage fund called ACTAI Ventures, A-C-T-I Ventures, which is named after this nonprofit because a lot of our community are investors in the fund. And we do get a lot of great deal flow through these events. So, and I co-founded that with Bill in 2021. And we're doing a lot of investing in AI and in blockchain. We're kind of, our overall thesis is that digitization helps make industries more efficient, processes more scalable, as you can imagine.
Both. And you guys targeting first check-in kind of thing?
Yeah, ideally we like to kind of pre-seed seed. Ideally, we don't, we like to kind of let the terms be set, and then, but we want to be like in the very first round.
Yeah, be on the front end, like Canva.
Yes. Canva's a good example.
Canva, for the folks who don't know, started here. Which ACTAI was it?
I think Bill might have met her in Australia. Then she came to Necker. There's a great article about her learning how to kite surf so she could like get in front of these group of people. Pitch. There's actually a wonderful Medium post that Bill wrote called the $30 billion stress test on Necker Island. And it talked about a young Melanie pitching Canva. It talked about the first time Zoom was literally being stress tested on an island. Othman LaRocky at the time was head of growth at Twitter. He's now the founder of Color Genomics, which has done extremely well as well. So I think Hero, which Bill ended up founding Treasure Data with, was also there. So it's just like, you know, at one point, I think the market caps of the founders of those companies have been over $200 billion. But, you know, at the time when he wrote the article, it was like $30 billion. So it's pretty insane. We'll see what happens with this trip. I can't promise we're going to get into that range of valuations from companies.
You never
know. You never know. There's always, you never know when you're going to find the next.
The WhatsApp group is really fun, engaging, just great people. Thank you again. Again, I'm just trying to do my part, sharing, podcasting, Brian and I, Brian Bauman.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you for Brian. You know, really special partnership with Brian, the New York Stock Exchange. I always say he is just a leader in the long vision lead gen for, you know, helping to nurture founders and meet them at an early stage, because it takes a while to get public, right? But like meeting companies like and people like Brian and the New York Stock Exchange can really help them. And then thank you for sharing your skills and enabling people to tell their stories.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, NYC Wired is blowing up in its trust network. It's Brian's the ambassador and leader, but there's more behind it, more coming. So what going on? We are here in Maui for ACTAI Global. I'm John Furrier. Thanks for watching theCUBE podcast. See you next time.